It was sunset. And I was standing on the edge of a wide, wide river that was slowly spilling its waters into the Bay of Bengal. The air was still, just a few tiny little waves ruffling the waters. A couple of skiffs heading out for the evening's fishing. And the sun sinking over the mangroves in the distance. And I was walking along the path towards the village and thinking how incredibly peaceful it all was. A little curl of smoke rising up above the thatch, the evening cooking fires being lit. And it struck me that if Bangladesh ever turned into a tourist hotspot, which it could well do, it's a beautiful country, a fabulous coastline, then this would be the kind of place that the tourist brochures would describe as having a timeless tranquility. And I got close to the village and I realized that all I could hear was da 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 beep 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 slashing through the evening's quiet. And it was all I could do not to punch the air with triumph, because this was exactly what I wanted to hear. This was the sound of global connectivity. This was the sound of a remote rural village being plugged into the global economy thanks to the twin 21st century miracles of solar power and mobile phones. Now, this is a village utterly cut off in the modern sense of the word, many, many miles from the nearest road, light years away from an electricity grid. The only source of power available would be diesel generators, dirty, polluting, wildly expensive, far out of the range of ordinary people. The only source of light would be kerosene lanterns. Now, there's something about the phrase kerosene lantern makes it sound rather romantic. The reality is a dirty little wick stuck in a Coke or a Pepsi bottle or just sitting on a saucer. It's smoky, it's dim, it's dangerous. If you try to read by it, your eyes start smarting from the smoke. It's very volatile, it's easily upset. You burn your clothes, your hair, your house down. And then along comes solar, along comes mobiles, and things start to change. For the price that you have to pay for the fuel for a single kerosene lantern, you can cover the installments on a solar home system that will give you 3, 4, 5 clean, bright LED lights. It means your kids can study in the evening, and education is the biggest ticket out of poverty. If you're a woman, you can do the cooking. I say if you're a woman, because in Bangladesh, sadly, that is always the way. If you're a woman, you do the cooking the same time as your kids study, same time as your husband's outside mending his fishing nets. Your economic prospects rise dramatically. And when it comes to the mobiles, a couple of fishermen were talking, telling me before and after mobiles. Before mobiles, they go out in their boats. They'd come in the morning, the heat would be rising, they'd have their catch, and they'd have to go straight to the nearest buyer, because otherwise the fish would spoil, they'd have to take whatever price they could get. After mobiles, they go out, they get their catch, and they get on their phone. And they phone this guy, and this guy, and this guy, and this guy, and they find out who's going to give them the best price. As tools of economic empowerment, solar and mobiles are quietly transforming tens of thousands of villages in Bangladesh. The company behind this particular scheme, Grameen Shakti, which is a spin-off of the Grameen Bank, which many of you will have heard of, which came up with the principle of microcredit, they've now sold over 1 million of these solar home systems. Further inland in Bangladesh, I came across another extraordinary project. A local NGO in the far northwest of the country, again an area where the only transport is rivers, where it's impossible to get teachers to turn up to school. This NGO had got together a fleet of 90 boats, specially constructed, big, wide boats. You get classrooms in them, covered them with solar panels. So they were connected to the outside world. They got power for computers, laptops, lights. And they ran them up and down the rivers. And during the flood season, they'd be shelters, flood shelters. During the rest of the time, they ran schools in them, particularly girls' schools. And they also ran them as mobile agricultural advice centers. So farmers would come on board, and they'd be connected by Skype to agricultural experts in universities maybe 100 miles away. So the farmer could hold up a dodgy tomato in the Skype and say, what's wrong with this? And the agricultural advisor would say, you've got lesser spotted tomato blight or whatever it was. You need to do this, this, and this. These are just two examples of a quiet wave of sustainable innovation that is sweeping across much of Africa and Asia. There are many others. It might be clean burning cook stoves, which save women hours of time collecting firewood, which save them large amounts of money when they have to pay for fuel, which means that they don't inhale smoke deep into their lungs and their children don't get sick from living in an atmosphere that smells as though somebody's been smoking 60 cigarettes a day. It might be smart greenhouses combining traditional earth and straw insulation up in Kashmir, in the high Himalayan valleys, in Ladakh, with UV-resistant polythene in place of glass, which enables people to grow vegetables right through the winter. And for people up there who don't have access to air-freighted vegetables coming in 6 months of the year, it can make the difference between their children going up healthy and their children growing up sick. It might be solar-powered cash machines spreading across India, bringing banking services in range of the rural poor. It might be smart filters, like a Tata Swatch filter, combining simple rice husks with nano filters to clean water at a price which makes it affordable for all but the very poorest families. And it seems to me that this quiet wave of sustainable innovations that are lifting people out of poverty and at the same time tackling climate change by shifting from polluting high carbon sources of fuel to cleaner low carbon ones, that this is a kind of a new environmentalism. An environmentalism that's practical, down to earth, transforming people's lives, and that has the prospect of saving environmentalism from itself. Because old environmentalism was largely telling people not to do things, and largely telling people to be afraid of imminent doom. And it's not surprising, there's quite a lot to be afraid about. And when environmentalists started raising these concerns back in late 60s, early 70s, they assumed that all they needed to do was draw people's attention to impending crisis, and the scales would fall from their eyes, and they'd rise up as one and make the changes required, and the planet would be saved, and we'd all live happily ever after. And when that didn't happen, understandably perhaps they got more strident. Be afraid, be very afraid, the world is dying. Be afraid, the wolf is coming round the corner. Be afraid, can't you see it? And people would say, well, yeah, a few things getting worse, but you know, life goes on, the sun still rose this morning, and the years would go by, 20, 30, 40 years would go by, we'd still have an environmental crisis, and environmentalists like me would still be shouting about it, and we'd still be being largely ignored, apart from people patting us on the head and saying we're doing a very good job. And so when the fear didn't work, and fear doesn't work because fear is a very demotivating experience to have thrust upon you, they added the second evil trump card of old environmentalism, which was guilt. The world is dying and it's all your fault. If you switch on that light, you'll flood the Maldives. How dare you go on that plane for a holiday? You're trashing the planet. Don't you dare have a good time. And this is, not surprisingly, spectacularly ineffective. And particularly for those billions of people around the world, from Bethnal Green to Bangladesh, who don't actually feel they've got very much to feel guilty about. The new environmentalism has got to be about doing more, not doing less. It's got to be about inspiring people that we can tackle climate change, but also, by doing so, give people a better life in the here and now. And doing more is going with the grain of human nature. You know, this clumsy ground-dwelling ape that we all are, we would not have crawled out of the Rift Valley and all across this planet unless we were good at doing stuff. And we like doing stuff. We like aspiring. We like reaching to the stars. And environmentalism, it's always trying to push you down, push you down, push you down, tell you shouldn't do that, shouldn't do that, shouldn't do that, is not going to key in to that essential human heartbeat. So rather than paralyzing people with fear, how much better it is to excite us with possibilities. And possibilities there are, legion of them. I talked a tiny bit about solar. To just throw out a few things, a few non-wolves coming round the corner. Price of solar is falling. It's already approaching grid parity in many countries. In other words, it will be cheaper over time to get your electricity from solar than getting your electricity from coal or gas. There are new forms of solar coming on stream. Organic solar based on carbon rather than silicon, which could lead to whole buildings being clad with energy-generating materials, so you wouldn't have solar modules on the roof. The solar would be the entire building. An Indian entrepreneur I was talking to a few months ago is confidently predicting that there will come a day before too long when a villager will be able to go down to the market in Uttar Pradesh and pick himself up a solar spray can and come back home and spray his roof with energy. There are all sorts of other possibilities just over the horizon. They won't arrive on their own. They won't arrive without the right political decisions being made. They won't arrive without the right sparky entrepreneurs to make them happen. But they are around the corner. They promise, or they hold out the promise, that the days of burning fossil fuels may soon seem absurdly irrelevant. And if it all sounds like science fiction, cast your mind back, or imagine yourself back 25, 30 years ago, when the idea that a Bangladeshi fisherman would have a communications device of a range and sophistication that we could only dream of. That would also sound like so much science fiction. And one of the little treats of the new environmentalism is it just hold out the prospect of leveling the playing field just a touch between the rich world and the poor world. Now, we've already seen in recent years the rise of collaborative consumption, peer-to-peer trading, things like Airbnb, people buying and selling from each other direct thanks to technology. Well, in this more connected world, it wouldn't be too fanciful to imagine that you could see that sort of direct peer-to-peer connection between Bethnal Green and Bangladesh. So just imagine that we've priced carbon at a rate that is commensurate with its potentially catastrophic impact. And imagine that we have a global peer-to-peer carbon trading regime in place. So there's you in your flat in Bethnal Green, ready to go easy jetting off on your stag weekend to Prague, dear God. And you've emitted a share of carbon in your time, so you need to buy some carbon credits to be able to do this. And there's Hussein sitting in his skiff in the Bay of Bengal, and he doesn't burn much carbon, so he's got plenty of credits. So you do a deal. So there are you in Prague, getting wasted on dodgy Pilsner. And there's Hussein in his skiff, gently hauling in his catch. And you have a wonderful, gentle rebalancing of economic power. And the fascinating thing about this, if it really takes off, is not just what it would do for global equity, which would be rather wonderful, but that suddenly all those old Buddhist texts would take on a different meaning. The ones about how you sit still in your room and you achieve true spiritual wealth. Well, now you'd be achieving true spiritual wealth and some pretty hefty financial wealth as well. Now, obviously, sooner or later, if this went on for too long, then somebody would have to shift their arse and do something. Otherwise, we'd all starve or freeze to death, all be under the skies of a wonderfully benign climate. And you could imagine what the Daily Mail would say about it all. Carbon trading, a dosser's charter. But meanwhile, it would be a rather lovely demonstration of what's possible in a society which is, in so many ways, shrinking its borders, dissolving its borders. And that could be one of the sweetest products of the new environmentalism. Thank you.